open up. And one of the aspects of Vatican II is to look positively at others and to start looking for the signs of the times and the spirit of God hovering over the whole world. And opening up the concept of church, not just to those who are not only baptized, but also who accept the Pope, which was our own idea of the church, the true faith. Because if we follow that now, there are just about a few of us now who really belong to the true faith in this world. But now, the church is different. We're talking more about the church of God, but not in the typical evangelistic term of the church being only that which is in the mind of God kind of thing, and that here we don't know. No, we're not talking in that terms. We're talking more in terms of the church as the people of God that God himself is bringing out around themselves. And we managed to find a way of retaining the fact that we are the true church, but at the same time, oh, there are also others who are in the true church. That's already a big progress forward. And realizing that we just should, the more we see that makes us one with others, the more we should rejoice in God, not the other way around. And so that together the world may believe and understand that, you know, it depends on how you read your scriptures. When people read John chapter 20, that all may be one so that the world may believe, they take it to me so that everybody will join our church. But you can also read so that the world may believe, so that the Lord may accept the message of the Lord Jesus, so that the world will be a better place, so that his kingdom will be promoted. And if we are not united, that will not happen. So Vatican II was famous for opening up, not only to fellow Christians, and since then you see the progress in ecumenism, a progress which has not been even, it's been going up and down. Sometimes it moves fast, sometimes it slows. I think sometimes it even goes into reverse gear. Like we are having with Archbishop Josiah and his people, Catholic Anglican dialogue. When I was finishing my doctorate in Rome in 1975, we thought that we were just about to sign an agreement of a mutual recognition of ministries. And we are almost there. And now we know that we still have, there are new bridges to cross. But everything is in God's hand. But I think the intentions are still there. And this is where, starting from fellow Christians, we then move out to others too. And the Vatican II documents, the two major ones that we should look at is Lumen Gentium, which gives the concept of the church, people of God, that is in various forms. And then the specific one that concerns Islam, the Nostra Aetate, the relationship of the church with other religions. And I think you should, whenever you are reading the one that talks specifically of Muslim, it is important to also take the trouble to look at Lumen Gentium, which is the dogmatic constitution, whereas Nostra Aetate is more a pastoral document on what to do. Now, if you want a classical text, I would say there are two. The first one is from Lumen Gentium. It refers to Muslims that the Muslims profess to hold the faith of Abraham. And together with us, that's the point, together with us, they adore the one merciful God, mankind's judge on the last day. Vatican II documents are very careful in their formulation. It did not just simply say that Muslims hold the faith of Abraham. No, it's a Muslims profess that they hold the faith of Abraham. That much you can at least say, because their documents tell us that. Well, see, this is the point. When I say Muslims profess to hold the faith of Abraham, there are many of my colleagues who say, yes, that's what they profess to do, but they really don't. And from that point on, dialogue breaks. And together with us, they adore the one merciful God. The merciful God is from the Islamic terminology itself, the Arab meaning. Mankind's judge on the last day. The more detailed one, and permit me to read it. How many minutes have I? Five?
Three, please.
The church also has high regard for the Muslims. but also is because they have spoken about other religions. And they were also as highly there for the Muslims. They worship God. This time it's not only that they profess to worship God. They tell us that they do. They worship God, who is one, living and subsistent, merciful and almighty, the creator of heaven and earth. You can see, if you tell that to the worshippers of Olodumare and of Romino in Oyo, they will say, that's true. The story is told of an old man who decided to become a Christian and he went to catechism class. In our old catechism, the first question is, who made you? And the answer obviously is, God made me. So the old man was told to start learning to by heart so that he can reply properly. Who made you? He said, but who is asking that stupid question? So of course God made us. But for him, to even ask the question, who made you, he's stupid. Now, I continue with Vatican II, that they believe in one God who has also spoken to men. They carefully avoided mentioning the Prophet Muhammad, may the peace of Allah be upon him. But it also states that Muslims believe that God has spoken to men. That's in reference to the concept of revelation in Islam. What exactly this revelation is, it is silent. Then decides to avoid mentioning it at all. They strive to submit themselves without reserve to the hidden decrees of God. Hidden decrees of God, this famous Islamic fatalism, but which can also mean submission to God. Just as Abraham submitted himself to God's plan, the importance of Abraham, the faith of Abraham in Islam. Abraham, to whose faith Muslims eagerly link their own. Although not acknowledging him as God, they venerate Jesus as a prophet. His virgin mother, for us Catholics, it's important to stress that it is his virgin mother. His virgin mother, they also honor Maria. And even at times, devoutly invoke. Further, they await the day of judgment and the reward of God, following the resurrection of the dead. For this reason, they highly esteem an upright life and worship God, especially by way of prayer, almsgiving, and fasting. This is 1965, and it was revolutionary at that time that the church at the highest level was saying these things. And they said it with the cooperation of bishops who came from these Muslim lands. And it was a tough discussion in the hall of the council. And many of the bishops from Muslim land was very careful that we should not say too much about these things. Now, in paragraph which is more programmatic, over the centuries, many quarrels and dissensions, they should have said also violent wars and bloodshed, but we don't want to say nasty things in documents. Over the centuries, many quarrels and dissensions have arisen between Christians and Muslims. The Sacred Synod now pleads with all, both Catholics and the Muslims themselves, to forget the past, I don't know whether it's possible, and urges that a sincere effort be made to achieve mutual understanding. Why? For the benefit of all men. That's how it says it. That was when it was agreed that men includes also women. There was no problem in 1965 about all these things. For the benefit of all men and women, let them together preserve and promote peace, liberty, social justice, and moral values. That gives the motivation for coming together. And it's already 40 years, and these texts still talk to us as if it was written yesterday. This is the text that has guided everything. Immediately after the council, the theology of non-Christian religions became a major element in all our theological institutions. Every priest was supposed to make sure that they at least know these things before they go out. I was a rector of the major seminary in Ibadan for 6-7 years. And we always had a Muslim professor from the